of the Saints. Coming up, all the painful highlights from Sunday's loss in the Superdome. We'll meet the guy who beat the Saints, Southern Mississippi, Brett Favre.
Make some noise now, you hear?
We'll spend a Sunday with the crazy man. And we'll take you on to the dance floor at Rickey Jackson's new nightclub. This was hard to swallow, but this wasn't, and neither is Saints Sideline. Next.
Hello, and thanks for joining us on Saints Sideline. I'm Ed Daniel.
I'm Alexander Lamont. You know, Fast Eddie, the loss to the Packers, really a tough one. I mean, especially because they dominated statistically. They had such a dominance there, but when it counted, they couldn't get it done.
Couldn't get it done, and this is a game that the Saints just simply should not have let get away, and I think you have to put a lot of the blame on the shoulders of the head coach, Jim Mora. The Saints are now 1-3 in their last four games. Not a good omen when heading in to San Francisco Monday night. Five Saint turnovers kept the Packers close. Then with under 2 minutes to go, Brett Favre made the big play, and Green Bay rallied to beat the Saints 19-17.
Sterling Sharp running free on second down and 20. Another verse in the Saints chapter of Blow the Big Ones. How could Sharp get by Gene Atkins?
My guy went underneath me and Bench and I trade off, and usually I look backside for what we call a six cut, and I saw Sterling running through the post, and there was no one there. So I just started to chase him because I knew the ball was going to come. I believe Brett broke contain, which allowed him to get outside and set up and make the throw, but we need to have some people back there, and until I threw the film, you know, I can't really speculate or comment.
Yep, blown coverage, but only one of numerous mistakes, like the one from the head coach, who chose three straight runs in a drive that started at the Saints 31 with 2:11 to play.
That was my decision. You know, I mean, it was make them use the timeout, run the ball, make them use our timeout. We throw it, incomplete. They still got a timeout. We got to punt, the clock stops, you know. So I felt that was the best thing to do at that point.
If the Saints throw an incomplete pass or Green Bay is forced to use their last timeout, 1:37 would still be left on the clock. Packers didn't need to go the length of the field, just get close enough for one of the league's best, Chris Jackie. His 36-yarder with three ticks left was true.
Never a doubt, man.
How's your heart?
What a game, huh?
Too many opposing coaches have come to the Superdome and said just that. But that's what happens when you can't shut the door again.
Sports writers covering Green Bay feel as though the win Sunday may put the Packers over the hump. Here's what they're saying. Bob McGinn of the Milwaukee Journal writes, the Green Bay Packers came to the Louisiana Superdome physically battered, mildly dispirited, and somewhat uncertain what their lot would be in the NFL this season. They left feeling as though they could conquer the world. Regardless of what happens in the division, the Packers made a huge stride towards securing at least a wild-card berth in the playoffs. Not only did the victory give them an edge on New Orleans in any playoff tiebreaker, but it also came in perhaps the most difficult game on their second half schedule.
Of course, this week is the biggie for the Saints. If they want to have any hopes of winning the NFC West, the Saints will play Monday night in Candlestick Park against the 49ers. San Francisco picked up a game on the Saints by pounding Tampa Bay Sunday. First quarter, no score. Steve Young pump fakes and hits Jerry Rice for the touchdown. San Francisco built a 17-0 lead. But the Bucs rallied. Craig Erickson, the ex-Miami Hurricane, fakes and finds a wide-open Vince Workman. The Ohio State Buckeye will score. The Bucs cut the lead to 17-14, and they were fired up. But it didn't last, as you would expect, against the 49ers. Second quarter, Young to Rice again. Rice is interfered with. Doesn't matter. 51-yard touchdown, 31-14, Niners at half. And then in the third, Young to Rice again. The fourth time they hook up for a score, San Francisco cruises. 45-21. Coming up, Southern Mississippi's finest. We'll meet the Favre family.
And we'll spend a game day with one of the maniacs. Meet the Saint Who Dat Man when Saints Sideline continues.
Is Brett Favre a good enough quarterback to take the Packers to the Super Bowl? Perhaps not yet, but many feel it could happen soon. The Southern Mississippi native brought the family along Sunday to watch him pass the test in his latest NFL lesson.
Rooting for the Saints as a youngster taught Brett Favre all about crisis. Some folks just don't like a quiet, smooth ride. Brett Favre is one of them.
Brett is a tough job, and he's going to do nothing but get better. So, I mean, Brett has to be concerned about what needs to be done for this team instead of what concerned about what people say and what the reporters say about it.
Barbecued after the loss at Kansas City on Monday night, Favre showed the Saints his wares on the winning drive, avoiding a sack by Vince Buck and hitting Jackie Harris for 5 on 4th and 3. And, of course, finding Sterling Sharp for the lethal 54-yarder. When Favre entered his press briefing, he said to one of the Packers' staff,
"Please tell him just two questions."
Yes, sir.
Then he answered all of them. Did Brett expect Sharp to be that wide open?
No, you know, when you scramble out there, you're hoping. But I wasn't, you know, I left the huddle, I wasn't saying, hey, Sterling's going to be that wide open.
Did Sharp's bout with double vision worry Favre?
You know, he's the guy we really go to in those situations, and I don't give a if he's having vision problems or not. He made the play.
Brett Favre's reputation as a gamer in college football has certainly carried over to the pros, and Saints fans can see why. Brett Favre feels he's the man to lead the pack all the way back.
I think he likes that role, and I think Brett will do everything he can to prove that.
Dad and Mom rounded up 63 others from the Favre party, headed up to their terrace seats for a high that Brett Favre called way up there.
Sitting here now, I can say it was one of the greatest victories and games I've ever been associated with. If we'd lost, I'd probably tell you it was one of the worst. But to come here, basically home for me, and to play against the Saints, a team I grew up pulling for, was something else.
And the Packers are a long way from those glory days. But on homecoming day, Brett Favre took the heat and delivered.
Of course, the vast majority of the 68,000 in attendance Sunday were rooting against Brett Favre. Photographer Thomas J. Pipitone followed one of them. His name is Don Touard. But in the Dome, he's known as the Saint Who Dat.
Big Saints game today. Packers in our backyard. I am Saint Who Dat, number one crazy Saints fan. All of a sudden they started winning. So I guess I just started something now. I can't stop it.
All right. Get this thing over. Okay, now. Don't want to mess my hair up. Okay. All right. That's one shot. Can't you just feel it, huh?
Well, God bless you. Oh, I say God bless you.
Okay, now you gotta tell me how to say Who Dat in Spanish again.
Who Dat?
It is? No, yeah, say Who Dat in Spanish. ¿Qué es eso? Go Saints.
Ready, willing, and able.
I got to, but I will not stop coming back to my football games for no reason. Go Saints!
Coming up next, a Saints legend goes clubbing. We'll visit Club 57.
And cleaning the bones. We'll have the disgusting highlights from the annual rib-eating contest on Saints Sideline continues. Saints definitely had their chances Sunday. Too many blown opportunities led to the loss that never should have happened.
The Packers turned three of the Saints' five turnovers into 13 points. Wade Wilson threw two interceptions and was responsible for one of three fumbles.
Outside of the turnovers, I thought we played extremely well. You know, we moved the ball up and down the field. We had some long drives, and it was the bad part about it is we stopped ourselves more than the Packers stopped us.
In the fourth quarter, Fred McAfee's 55-yard kickoff return was a golden chance for a TD. But the Saints got three.
Needless to say, Rickey Jackson was not happy after Sunday's performance. Number 57 was in much better spirits earlier in the week when we took a trip out to his new Kennard night spot.
This is his newest undertaking, Rickey Jackson's Club 57 in Kennard. The newest entry into the local nightclub scene, an adult-only night spot with exciting neon design that will feature both live and recorded music nightly, something Rickey says was needed in the area.
This spot was wide open in Kennard, you know what I mean? Kennard never had nothing like this, so, I mean, I'm from nearby this area, so I hang in Kennard a lot. And I think it was a good thing for the people from Baton Rouge and La Plage and Harmsville way, where they ain't got to go all the way into the city.
Will this investment be the next step for number 57 after football?
Well, I've been thought about after football. I mean, I wouldn't take nothing like this and try to, you know, go after football. My after football day's been put up, and I've been ready for that, you know, whenever it comes. So, I mean, Mr. Fink took care of that for me.
I saw you on the dance floor, Coop. I never have seen you on the field dancing, but I never really... saw you on the dance floor.
Hey, I'm no Michael
Jackson. The moves are a little different.
They're a little different. I'm a little bigger, so I don't want to elbow anybody. So I'm just going to stay in my little square. I'm more of a laid-back guy. I'm not going to dance or nothing like that. So, you know, my thing is just to come out and see them having fun. And I think most of the people here tonight is just, you know, Rickey Jackson fans. So, I mean, that makes it feel even special.
Does it matter that it's Rickey Jackson's club? Does it matter that it's Rickey's place?
No, not really. I just like to come and get some good entertainment, quality entertainment, and great. In fact, I don't even know who Rickey is.
Thank goodness you didn't dance.
I almost did.
Spare us. Before spending Friday night at Club 57, Richard Cooper spent Wednesday night devouring ribs. Coop and four other hungry Saints took part in the annual charity rib-eating contest at Morten Andersen's Champions Restaurant.
Ready!
What a great cause. You know, Skip is such a worthy cause. Sick kids involve people, and that's what it's all about. My heart is very close to helping kids, and that's what we did tonight. Great turnout. People were great sports, and there were a lot of hungry people, that's for sure.
Any special technique to eat ribs that quick?
Be very hungry. Very, very. I just try to rip the bone off and just have nothing but meat left so I can just, you know, go at it and not to worry about chewing on something hard.
Now, when you got to the Saints this year, anything mentioned in the contract about having to participate in anything like this?
No, this was brought to me about 2 hours ago. The more you have to pay for this.
As a head coach of this event, I would say that's pretty good preparation and good focus on the part of the guys, and I'm real pleased, and, you know, we got to get ready for Green Bay now.
Coming up next, the improved running game. Rupert Jordan will join us to talk about Derrick Brown's efforts, the Packers game, and the 49ers. All that's next on Saints Sideline.
Hi, five turnovers, there were a few bright spots for the Saints on offense. Among them, Eric Martin hit yet another career milestone, and the Saints rediscovered the running game.
This 60-yard jaunt by Derrick Brown signified the return of the Saints' ground game. The team picked up 157 yards. That's the best since week three. Derrick Brown got 106 of it, the second 100-yard game of his career.
Before, it was just probably just one man, just needed to be blocked, and you know, I for myself, there were some bad reads on my own. I needed to correct those. I needed to be a little bit patient, more patient with the players, let them develop first, and that's exactly what I did today.
Eric Martin hit another career milestone, nabbing career reception number 500.
The Saints will obviously have to play better, a lot better, to have a chance against the 49ers Monday night. To recap the Packers game and look ahead to that one, we go on the bench with Buford Jordan. Buford, the Saints made five turnovers. Would we be simplifying it and saying that that really was the difference?
I think it was, you know, because you look down when the first interception occurred, you know, they had a nice drive going, and then boom, Green Bay gets it and, you know, stops the drive. And it hurt them quite a bit, you know, and you can't take that away. Turnovers is what kills you.
2:11 left in the game. You've got the two-minute warning, and Green Bay has two timeouts. To me, make a first down and get it over with. That's not the route that Mora took, and I know hindsight's always 20. I'll go 20-20. I'm on a record say he made a mistake. Did he make a mistake?
Obviously he did. You know, I mean, you look at the third down and, what, 10, and, you know, you got a decision to pass or run. I mean, hey, Green Bay has one timeout. You run, you don't make the first down the clock. They'll call a timeout and stop it. You know, it's even the same thing as if you pass. You know, they may complete it, get a first down. If you don't, the clock stops anyway, and you still have to punt. So I think they should have passed instead of trying to run for it. You know, 3rd and 10, you know you're not going to make it if you haven't done it in the first two downs.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about San Francisco moving up to next week. Pretty much even now. What do the Saints have to do now differently to beat this team?
Well, I think the thing that for them to beat this team is the coach is going to have to start making better play selections. I mean, they make play selections yesterday, and, you know, sometimes it was repetitive. I mean, you look at the pass, the first pass Eric Martin caught, you know, when Brad Muston went in motion, they did that. Then they came back, and Derrick Brown makes a nice run. Then they come back and run the same play to Eric again on the interception. You know what I mean? You got to do different things. You can't do a play and then do another play and then do the same play you did before that.
Prediction?
Well, I think it's going to be a tough game for them. And like I said, unless the play calling improves, they're going to be in for a rough one Monday night.
A rough one Monday night indeed. For being our guest, you get lifetime membership at Club 57.
Thank you very much.
Please, calm down. Up next, we'll check out the playoff picture, how it's stacking up, and the Saints talk about the Niners. That's next on Saints Sideline. Let's get out of here.
Thanks to their win over the 49ers back in September, the Saints are still on top of the NFC West. They're 6-3, but the next three games are all on the road. The Lions have the week off. Detroit leads the Central at 7-2, and the Dallas Cowboys beat Phoenix to also move to 7-2. The New York Giants are the best of the rest at 6-3. The Niners are also 6-3, and the Minnesota Vikings won a big one in Denver. They currently hold down the final wild card spot at 5-4. Of course, for the Saints, the big Monday nighter is next.
We're going to start it back up again. We're going to get together this week, and we're going to look at the films again and reevaluate ourselves again. You know, we'll see what minor things that occurred and take care of it and go out and try and, you know, go out and win against the 49ers.
Just like season just started. We played the first game of the season. That's all. I mean, both of us, all of us, 0-0. You know, we got a chance to go up a notch on them, or they go up a notch on us. So I think we're ready for them. We beat them last time. We'll get them again.
That game kicks off Monday night at 8 o'clock.
And we'll get you ready for it with our WGNO Sports Special, San Francisco Showdown. That's live from Candlestick Park, Monday night at 6:30.
A special edition of Saints Sideline will air Tuesday night at 7 as we wrap up the 49ers game. Then Tuesday night at 7:30, join Brett Maxey and me for the Ultimate Saints Shopping Guide, the Saints Holiday Shopping Network, Tuesday night at 7:30. It is going to be a busy week, Fast Eddie.
And you like
I really do like the Saints against the 49ers.
Okay, I'll take the 49ers and doesn't take a brain surgeon to figure that one out, but we'll see.
Okay, I'm Alexander LaRon.
And I'm Ed Daniels. We'll see you Monday night live from the stick. Good night.
Good night.
Oh, we wanted to come out of this with a win and go into Frisco with a win, but no, you know, we lost a close one. We have to just suck it up and come back next week and go against the big boys.
I just know that if we ever get to where we're playing as well as we can play, there's no team that can beat us, and I feel confident with that. I'm sure people are going to dwell on the negativity like they always do, but, you know, we got a chance to beat the Niners, and we got to beat the teams.